Hello everyone, new video this week with a completely new format because this week I want to talk about an article that I actually saw pop up quite a few times on social media. So maybe you saw it pop up too. It's called Apple is Killing Swift. If you've seen the article, I'm sure that you remember this thumbnail. And I wanted to talk about it because even though I don't necessarily agree with everything said in the article, once I had read it, I felt that there was some kind of interesting takeaway I had from it that was worth sharing with everyone else. So let's go ahead and let's jump into the article. So I'm not going to read the article in this video because it wouldn't make for the most interesting content. I've put the link in the description and feel free to read it on your end in details. But just to go over what this article is saying, it's written by someone who seems to have a very good technical knowledge of Swift, that seems to be quite involved in the Swift evolution process. And it's more a criticism of Swift's internal governance process, so how the decisions about which new features should be added to the language are made. So the article talks a bit about the history of Swift, the fact it was created by Chris Lattner as a project with, we could say, a technical founder that had a pretty clear vision. It talks about the fact that Lattner took a step back from the project and now is no longer involved with the project from the past few years, if I'm correct. Talks about the fact that Swift has gained indeed quite a lot of keywords over the years. It talks about also how other programming languages manage to govern their evolution processes. So I learned a few things because it talks about how Python, Rust, and Kotlin manage their evolution. And it ends up talking about the fact that for Swift, there is the fact that Apple is behind the language. Apple pays the salaries of a lot of the core team members of Swift. And even though Swift is open source and part of the evolution discussions happen in public, there is still Apple behind that has a strong incentive and a strong stake in the evolution of the language. And when I read the article, what I found interesting is that it was talking about topics that I was aware of. For instance, the fact that with Swift 5.1, there were several additions to the language that never made it through a proper evolution process before they were announced. And that's because these new features were the underlying blocks behind SwiftUI. But what caught my attention was that the author seemed to be much more annoyed at this situation than I was myself as a Swift engineer. And to be fair, I haven't met that many people that shared this level of frustration about how Apple manages the evolution of Swift. And so that's the reason why I wanted to talk about this article, because the more I read the article, the more I realized that the person who wrote this article, like I said, is someone that seems to be very knowledgeable and very involved in the Swift evolution process. You can see that that person talks about some pretty, I don't want to say niche, but pretty specific issues and exceptions made inside the compiler that, to be perfectly clear, I had no idea that they existed. But of course, as you start to learn more about compiler stuff, you get to learn about these things. And so I realized one thing, basically, and I think I'm going to stop scrolling because I've said what I wanted to say about the article. I think the one thing that I realized was that this article was not written by someone that just uses Swift to write apps, but by someone that was quite involved in the inner workings of Swift, in the Swift evolution process. And it made me realize one thing, which is that Swift is open source in the sense that you can have access to the source code of the compiler, you can have access to the Swift forums, you can follow the Swift evolution process. However, as the article says, even though it says it maybe in a more inflammatory way than I would have said it, Apple is behind the Swift evolution and Apple has a strong stake in the Swift evolution process. And so if an engineer decides to dedicate a lot of their time and energy into the evolution of Swift, it's very possible and I would say very easy to get into a situation where you give a lot of your focus and your energy, and then you become disappointed and frustrated because you realize that most of the decisions are made in part or totally by Apple, and you don't have as much sway in the decision as you would have in another programming language where there isn't such a strong corporate backer. And that's what it made me realize, is that the way Swift is doing open source makes it very easy to fall into this situation where you have the illusion that you can have a lot of influence and control over the evolution of the language, even though in actuality, well, you won't have, because there is Apple behind it, and Apple has a very strong incentive and is going to deploy a lot of resources so that Swift goes into the direction that they want it to go. So that's why I wanted to share this article, basically, and that's why it's the first time I share such an article, but I found the cautionary tale to be worth sharing. Personally, I've never really contributed to Swift open source, mostly because I'm more interested in content creation, but I guess maybe also I kind of maybe felt a bit that is the kind of topics where you can end up spending a lot of energy and then be disappointed by what's the return on it. And I think what's particularly tricky is that you don't control the entire process, and the part of it will never be under your control, whether it's total control or partial control, which is very different, for instance, from what I do with content creation, where I do have, yes, YouTube can have an impact, but in the end, I decide which kind of content I make, and I have a lot more control over my content than I would have over a potential feature of Swift if I was to dedicate the same amount of energy to a potential Swift evolution proposal. And so, yeah, I guess that's the message I wanted to share, that if you're an engineer that's pretty good, pretty technical, and that wants to involve themselves into the evolution of the language, please make sure that you are very clear on what you want to get from it. And if you expect to have a lot of influence over the evolution of the language, maybe try to see in the past how things went so that you don't end up into this situation where you get frustrated by the fact that you've spent a lot of time on something and it didn't yield maybe the result that you expected. Because that's kind of the feeling I had when I read the article. The person who read it seems to be someone with a lot of technical knowledge, but seems to be a reasonable person. And still, this person feels extremely frustrated at what's happening. And so I'm like, this kind of frustration is never good to feel. So I guess that's what I wanted to share. Like, don't spend your evenings contributing to Swift if you're not very clear on what you expect to take from it, because it might be a path that leads to a lot of frustration. So that's all for this video. As you've seen, completely new format. I recorded this video in almost one go, no written script. So maybe I will be looking less like an AI in this video. Honestly, I hope so, because if it doesn't, then I don't know what to do. But I would really love to have your feedback on this new format. If you liked it, please let me know in the comments. If you hated it, please also let me know in the comments. It's important for me to know it. If you have other articles that maybe you'd like me to read and share my opinion on, please share them with me also in the comments. As always, don't forget to leave a like if you enjoyed the video, to subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss the next ones. And thank you for watching, and see you next time.